post commentary can be sort of abrupt, you know, starting and ending. Anyway, this is welcome back to Strinder. This is Game Soup.
Wait, did you just call it Strinder?
Did I?
Ed, you called it Strinder.
Okay, we got to start over.
No. We're not starting it over. You wouldn't let me start it over. I called it Strinder for several episodes, and now that you're calling it Strinder, you want to start over? It doesn't work like that.
Yeah, but I'm the master,
buddy.
I'm the Vegas master. I am in control.
You could edit that out and make yourself not look like a fool.
But I won't.
All right, it's Game Soup. We're playing Strider. This is part 5. And it's in post. We already mentioned that, though.
So. It's in post. Very post.
Heck yeah.
Post. Oh, let's turn the sound up. I was like, why can't I hear anything?
Yeah, we should have our sound up so we can hear all of Strider's battle cries.
Wait.
Is there no sound?
It's extremely quiet.
Yeah, it's there, though.
Okay,
cool. We're there. Oh, all right, God. Little behind the scenes look for you there.
But they didn't see anything.
True. So I think, are we going back through? Yeah, we're going back through this test subject segment of the game here, I think.
Who's
and I'm
you?
Taking a different path.
Who's the test subject? You?
Yeah. They're testing Strider's abilities, but they're failing to kill him.
It seems pretty hard to do, actually.
Yeah, we're going back through, so I'm taking the other path just so we can see this. I did mention it in another episode that we would be returning here, and I didn't lie.
You didn't lie.
And I think the reason why I went back was because I thought there was a power-up down here. I thought they would have hidden a power-up, but they didn't. It was just a waste of time, except to just see some more rooms in the game.
You know, I gotta say, we've been watching this, and like, I've been paying, I don't know, at least half attention. No, I shouldn't even say that. I've been paying attention, right?
Yeah.
But a lot of the areas in this game look identical. I gotta say.
We have seen this. The neon lights level, neon lights area,
I think that looks
very different. But yeah, it's all kind of
industrial gray.
Industrial and kind of a little bland, and it's kind of I think it's based on like a communist place, you know, where everything is uniform.
Yeah.
It's based on
I think
that's on purpose, but also it's not they probably could have made it more interesting with the color palette. I don't know. Do you guys think?
Yeah. Even just the architecture, like it's all like
The architecture. Yeah, you're right.
Like this is not a single building, right? I'm assuming, like this part of the game, you go through different locales. Like you start the game on a snake, for God's sake, a flying robot snake.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, but I don't know, it seems like for a while we've been here killing these dudes. I'm just in this base killing these dudes, you know.
Yeah, a lot of the enemies are. They're palette swaps, and there are a lot of similar enemies. Like, you'll see shield guys, but there's, like, 4 different ones. One for each color of sword that you have, because you need to use a certain color of sword to break their shields. Some of them you break with a charge shot, and then there's an orange one, a blue one, and a purple one, and they have to be broken with the colored swords.
Hey, I was just thinking of something about colors.
And they'll start introducing They'll introduce the shielded enemy before you actually get the thing that can kill them. So there will be invulnerable enemies. Luckily, they're not that difficult because they just shoot single bullets at you. You just have to avoid them for your first encounter with them. But then shortly after, they'll give you... It's not bad design, but it's... They'll shortly after give you the tool to kill them. Anyway, go ahead.
Do you know about Fruit Loops? How you know that that's a thing? I mean, you do, of course, Joe. But for the viewer.
The cereal.
Okay. Yeah. Did you know that every color of Fruit Loops is the same flavor? It's just one flavor. Now, that may not be a mind bender to you. It may or may not be. I don't know. I thought it was kind of surprising.
Yeah, I guess they are. I haven't had Fruit Loops since I was a kid.
I haven't had them in a while either. But
I don't know.
I've read that. But then I was thinking, what about Fruity Pebbles? Because I'm pretty sure I would be amazed if all the Fruity Pebbles were actually the same flavor. I find that hard to believe. Am I right or am I wrong?
I don't know. That's Fruity Pebbles. I mean, you have to be mixing however many colors there are, 5 or 6 colors together in your mouth. You have to mix 5 flavors together, 5 artificial flavors have to taste good together.
That's,
and it's basically just a sweet mess. I mean,
yeah, that's why it seems implausible.
Fruity Pebbles, they taste the same from what I remember.
I don't remember. That's the problem. I haven't had Fruity Pebbles. I never liked them, though. Fruity Pebbles.
I used to buy Fruity Dino Bites.
Oh,
when
yeah.
I was in, I guess, college. Whatever. I was in school.
Yeah.
I used to buy the, you know, the welfare cereal.
You know,
the cheap stuff.
That's amazing.
Because
I used to buy Choco Dino Bites.
Wait, you did Choco Dino? I did Fruity Dino
Bites. Which was Cocoa Pebbles and Fruity Fruity Pebbles. In fact, I bought those as recently as, I think, 2010, maybe I was buying Choco Dino Bites.
Yeah.
That's actually not that recent anymore. But yeah, when I when I was out of college and I used to, you know, go food shopping for myself, that would be one of the things I picked up. I love cereal. Cocoa Pebbles is one of the best cereals. Straight up.
Well, I'm not going to argue with you.
I mean, there is a tier. We have talked about this before. I think we talked about this on Mercenary Kings. The cereal tiers. We've talked about the best cereals.
Oh,
I know.
I'm sure no one watching this has seen all our Mercenary Kings series.
No,
nobody's seen
because
that.
I haven't even seen all of them.
Yeah.
And I put them together. I just edited them.
Please don't go back that far.
No.
On the GS
Although,
catalog.
Please pump our views because we only have like 60 views on those. Actually, no, don't even. They're not worth your time.
Yeah, don't, please.
Cereal tiers, though. This is a very important topic because Cocoa Pebbles is undeniably one of the best cereals. However, Cinnamon Toast Crunch is a strong contender for number one, as is French Toast Crunch. Am I wrong, Joe?
No, you're right.
That is the holy trifecta of cereals. And I will not stand for any disagreement on this topic.
Okay, good, because I'm not that into the topic.
But Joe and I used to eat cereal all the time, right?
Let's talk about the Nintendo Switch.
Okay, so the Switch is out. And if you're watching this, this could be like weeks after the release.
Actually, I was going to mention that these episodes of Strider are probably all going to have been recorded before the first one even airs.
Yes. So, just for a little bit of context, I know we don't always want to reveal our secrets, because we're magicians, right?
But yeah, we shouldn't talk about anything that's too topical, but
I mean,
the information we're going to put forth is probably still going to be relevant to the Switch. It's March 5th we're recording this.
Unless this doesn't come out for another 5 years, it's going to be relevant for the Switch, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, let's talk about the Switch. It came out 2 days ago. 2 days, on Friday. Today's Sunday. There's a lot to talk about with the Switch. This is always a big deal. Anytime a new console is launched, it's a big deal. And I have a ridiculous amount of notes and things that I want to cover. Now, I have not touched a Switch. Have you, Joe?
No.
Nor have I ever played a Wii U. My last console was the Wii.
I played Wii U, but I don't have it.
I think I might have seen it once at a Target on display, but I didn't even play it then. And I was one of those guys that, I mean, Joe and I, the morning that GameCube came out in 2001, we stood outside of a Toys R Us at like 7:50 or 8 in the morning or 8:50.
Did you get a purple one?
I got a purple one. You got a black one, right?
No, I got a purple one. I wanted a purple one. Wait. Like, I wouldn't settle for a black one.
I didn't get a black one either. I definitely had a purple one.
I think you traded
with somebody.
Yeah, we had a trade in line. They gave you a random color because they didn't want to run out of a certain color. And the guy next to me wanted a black one, so I traded him. Okay, really, not a very interesting story, Joe. Okay, go.
Well, anyway, so Joe and I, as a... You know, we both stood on the morning of for the GameCube, but when the Wii came out, it took me a couple months. I had to... What did I even do? I think... Remember how scarce the Wii U was? There was like a... I mean, people always say that now. They look back on it cynically and say it was an artificial deficit in the supply. You know, you might have heard that at one point or another, that kind of theory. I don't know if I believe that. I don't know if I agree with that theory, but it was definitely hard to come by for months. Months and months and months, you couldn't get it. Like... Online, it was sold out. Toys R Us, Target, they were all sold out of the Wii. As soon as a new shipment came, they would, you know, release it.
Everybody remembers that.
People would line up.
Yeah.
And that happened for so long. And ever since then, Amiibo, same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Shortages
it's
of the product.
It's always Nintendo products, right?
It's always...
What's your theory?
Yeah. Well, I have one theory and one thing that I don't think is true, which is another theory. My other thing that I don't think is true theory is that, and you might have seen this opinion from some other people, is that, it's happening all on purpose. They're creating artificial scarcity so that people talk about their product and get hyped for it, and then you really get people interested in it. I don't think that's true. I would go for the Occam's Razor answer, which is they're just bad at knowing how many things to make. They're just bad at knowing that they needed this much supply.
What is Occam's Razor again?
It's the idea that often the simplest solution is the correct one.
Oh, okay.
You know? So in this case, sure, maybe they did this all intentionally. It was all a ploy. But maybe they just didn't know how many Amiibo to make. because they're making 50 or 60 different amiibo over the last couple of years, they didn't know that they needed 10,000 Pikachus instead of 9,000.
Oh, okay.
You know, so that's always been my thing. But, they did it with the Wii. They did it with the, I guess not the Wii U, because that didn't really sell like hotcakes. They did it with the amiibo. And my guess is, this is going to happen now with the Switch. Because if you look at Amazon today, Amazon is canceling it's a disaster.
Oh, really? I didn't know about this.
Yeah, and this tends to happen anyway during the release of consoles, but Amazon has canceled some pre-orders.
What the hell is the point of a pre-order if you're not guaranteed to get it when it comes out?
Yeah.
Pre-ordering is...
And along the same lines, what's the point of a pre-order?
Can I go on a quick pre-order rant here? It's not going to be real long, but my wife and I, we pre-ordered Final Fantasy XV, and she was pining over which place to pre-order it at, because you get a bonus.
Yep.
It's dumb, because some of it's DLC, some of it is...
alternate costumes.
Yeah, alternate costumes. It's mostly in-game stuff. I don't know if there was really any physical stuff, but... she did all the research, and we went with GameStop because they gave you a free game. We thought that was the best deal for PS4. So we didn't really even play the game that much. We didn't beat it, but we got the free game, so we had it there. It seemed pretty fun. It's a brawler. I like brawlers.
What's it called? Kingdom Souls?
Something like that. I forget. But we just looked on the store, and it's now available for free.
It's there now.
On the PS4.
I saw that a couple
of times. So what the hell was the point of pre-ordering?
To get it earlier than everybody else.
And also, there was an item that you could only get for, like, the deluxe edition or the special edition, where you had to pay $100 or a couple hundred dollars. I don't remember. But it was one of the... It was a special item that you were only supposed to be able to get with that version of the game.
Is that out, too?
3 months later, it's now a DLC for 50 cents.
Oh my god! I didn't know about that.
Stop pre-ordering games. That was it for me. Like, before that, I was like, there's too many people are over-exaggerating how bad pre-ordering is, but...
No, that's
the final... That's it.
It's pretty bad.
I don't think I'm pre-ordering a game ever again.
It's
ridiculous.
I'm a disciple of the Total Biscuit school of pre-ordering logic, pre-ordering philosophy, in that it's always bad. It sends the wrong... As a consumer, it sends the wrong signal to... It rewards bad behavior.
Oh, here's an example of a shield guy. He's an orange shield guy, and we do not have the orange sword yet, so we can't destroy those.
We just have to... What do we do, get that and come back?
Yeah, we have to get the orange sword.
I guess we're about to get it, huh?
Pretty soon, yeah. And you see that orange door on the map in the top right there. You might have to rewind to see it if you're watching at home, but that's a door that you can't access without the orange sword, which doubles as a key. Here we go. Here's a door right here.
Oh, nice.
You need an orange for. Perfect.
That is pretty interesting.
Yeah, so DLC and Nintendo Switch.
So, along the same lines, right? Product scarcity. That's cool. Also, don't pre-order, but that's a whole other discussion.
Nintendo Switch.
So, Amazon was canceling pre-orders, which I guess is kind of bound to happen anyway for something as big as this. But if you go on Amazon right now, on this day, March the 5th, beware, the 5th of March, November, this is called the Ides of March. No, wait, that's March 15th.
Isn't that St. Patrick's Day?
That's March 18th.
It is?
Isn't it?
I should probably know this.
What are holidays? Leave it in the comments. So the thing is, if you go on Amazon right now, and you type in Nintendo Switch, you're going to be able to buy it. But guess what, Joe?
What?
$420. That's the cheapest one I can find online. Scalpers. Scalpers are selling it for...
On Amazon.
On Amazon. Well,
that's interesting.
It's because on Amazon you can say, buy from other sellers. Available from other sellers.
Oh, yeah,
but Amazon
yeah.
themselves will say it's sold out.
This is actually a pretty cool sequence in the game. We're chasing the boss that we're about to fight here.
Where is he?
Here he is right there. He just jumped down.
Nice.
That Russian guy. He's the guy that's been taunting us in the bottom of the screen throughout the game. And, this is probably a good time to mention how annoying those text boxes can be to the gameplay sometimes.
Oh yeah?
It hasn't been that annoying yet, but there is a part in this game, and I will mention it when we get there, where those text boxes are the biggest enemy.
Mikhail!
Please look forward to that.
My name is Mikhail!
Yeah, there he is.
Hey, they spelled assassinate wrong.
They did?
Yes, it was A-S-S-A-S-I-N-A-T-E. Typos bug me a lot.
Oh, they do?
If I was ever going to be a Nazi, I would be a grammar Nazi. Hmm. Not like a... Oh, let's not even go there. So, but do you remember back when the Wii came out? Sorry, are we okay to do this?
Yeah, yeah, go.
When the Wii came out and you went on Craigslist and people were like, I'll sell you this Wii for
$600. Bucks, yeah.
And, NES Mini. That's the more recent
thing. Yeah, the NES Mini.
Same thing.
It's been
it was on eBay for, I don't know, like two or three times the MSRP. So, and that's what's happening now on Amazon and probably eBay as well. So, I don't know.
Yeah, I didn't know Amazon let you would let sellers get away with that type of stuff.
Well, I mean, they're like free eBay, to set their prices, you know?
Yeah.
Even if it's unethical. Although, I guess they would argue that it's not, because they were first in line to get pre-orders, so it's not unethical to resell them at a much higher price. But I remember people attempting that as early as the PlayStation 2, even. Or maybe it was the PS3, actually. But anyway, product shortages, they're crazy. So that's kind of what the Switch is going through right now.
This is a cool boss.
Hangar Bay Zeta. This is that boss.
So he gets in this tank. He's acting really tough in this tank. He won't be so tough when he's out of his tank, though, you'll see.
Does he take one hit to kill?
So this is like a memorization style boss done right, in my opinion. I like the way that this is set up. Yeah, you gotta be careful. You gotta be looking out for him coming out of the background and into the foreground here. And you'll see me spamming all of my magic abilities, all my mana abilities, when he comes to the foreground so he can do maximum damage to him.
There's a part like this in Money Number 9. It's like a 3-second section, though. And it's way crappier than this. That's what this reminded me of.
So yeah, we're trying to destroy these. I didn't do a great job on this particular part. But we're trying to destroy these flamethrower things before he comes into the foreground, so we don't have to deal with them when he gets there.
I'm noticing like a little bit of frame hitching, slowdown. Was that also present in the PS4?
During the actual gameplay? I don't think so.
So it's probably just the recording.
I think it's just the recording, yeah. I don't remember any slowdown during the gameplay. I could be wrong, but I don't think it was during the gameplay.
It's pretty brief, but it's noticeable here and there. I blame it on the PS4's recording capabilities, I suppose.
Yeah, it's not great, and we explained in another episode why we're not going to be doing it this way.
It was the first episode. Again. You know why? Because I watched it today. That's how I know.
Oh, cool.
I was preparing to render.
Oh, I get it.
Wow, that's a cool pattern.
You can slide under it. I think you can also jump over it. I usually tend to slide under that attack. So here we go, we got indicators.
My name is Mikhail, I shoot my missiles!
But there's so many, you just get in the air there and you can dodge them. And then they combine some of the elements together, and we got the flamethrower guys with the lasers that... Yeah, those laser things.
My name is Mikhail, in Pokemon Silver, I chose Totodile! My name is Mikhail. I watch Gilligan's Isle. Etc. Etc.
Yeah, keep going. No, you don't keep going.
My name is Mikhail. I watched the Green Mile. My name is Mikhail, which is actually Russian for Kyle. That's not true either, I think.
Okay, so I have to apologize here. My recording cut out right here. This is another reason why not to. Okay, I think that was the cut.
I was going to say it was pretty smooth.
This is the cut. So this is how he dies. He's pretty weak.
Oh my god.
You just reflect one bullet at him and he dies.
You only have knife. I have gun.
So I was really, really quick with the hitting the record button there, but I would have missed that cool cutscene there. So that's another reason why not to do recording in 15-minute chunks with the share feature. Is that you might miss a really cool moment or a cutscene like that. But luckily I just barely got it, so sorry about missing a few seconds there of the cutscene. Locate the Gravitron. Again.
Again? How many of these things are there?
A lot of Gravitrons. There? They really love the gravity altering in this universe.
They can't figure
out how to feed their people, but they can control gravity.
Some would say the same about us. By us, I mean the planet, not any specific country or person or individual, which is the same as a person.
So yeah, we just finally got the orange.
Oh, good. So now we can...
The orange sword. So now we can break through orange guy's shields. We can get through orange doors. And most importantly, we can inflict a dot on the enemies. That's damage over time.
Oh, is it a element-based dot or is it just a regular?
Just a dot. It's the only dot in the game. But I use it a lot. It's probably my most used sword for the rest of this playthrough.
I mean, that's pretty efficient. You know, if you're going for a speed run or a skill run... Dots are pretty efficient. That's where you want to be. Yeah, I just saw a little bit of frame drops. Actually,
yeah, there
still
are some,
going.
There are some frame drops there. That was, I'm pretty sure, 90% sure that was not actually in the gameplay. So if you're thinking about getting the game for PS4, I wouldn't worry too much about those frame drops. I would worry about them for PC, though.
Yeah.
This game is not optimized on the PC.
No. Now, if you look on the Steam forums for this game, you'll see a lot of topics about that.
Yeah, we probably should have mentioned that in the first episode. Hopefully,
I thought we did.
I'm pretty sure we did. Oh, yeah. We did? Okay, sweet.
Either... I don't remember hearing it today when I was watching it, but it might be in the first, like the end of the first episode or the second episode or something, but we definitely, I'm pretty sure we mentioned
Overall, it. Overall, the game is recommended, at least for PS4. That's what I played here, obviously, but...
Yeah, it was weird, you know, for a 2D game like this. You know, even Hollow Knight had a similar problem. That just came out, but that also had some strange...
Yeah, that's 2D graphics. This game is
yeah
2D gameplay, but 3D graphics, right. So you might expect it. But obviously, the graphics aren't that taxing, right? They shouldn't be that taxing for a reasonable PC. They're not... It's not, what's a new game?
Crysis. Wait, that's not new anymore.
Anything that came out in the last year, okay?
Oh, Horizon Zero Dawn.
Yeah.
That game is gorgeous.
I was actually going to mention that one, but I was trying to think of something that was also out for PC. But, yeah, I've been looking at some footage of that. It looks pretty awesome, but didn't buy it. That's one I probably might get on sale.
Yeah.
I don't have a ton of money to spend on $60 games all the time, but... It looks pretty nice.
Speaking of new games, the new Zelda launched with the Switch.
Oh, yeah.
I've been watching other people play it, which is probably a really bad idea because it spoils the experience. My screen, I should just turn that off.
Yeah, Zelda games, especially the newer ones, you want to be... I think if you're going to play it, you should probably just
play it
blind.
Even if I wanted to, how would I do it? I would have to pay $420
At this point, yeah, if you want to play it. Launch, you can't unless you're rich or lucky, right?
You can just get the Wii U version, but even then I have to buy a Wii U. You know?
Yeah, and then you're playing an inferior version.
I mean, it's only slightly inferior. I'm pretty sure they started development on the Wii U.
Oh, okay. But, so it's not that much different then?
But I would still rather play it on the Switch because, you know.
And at this point, for most games, especially Nintendo games and games that aren't hyper-realistic... The consoles aren't going to be the thing that's going to bring down the graphics quality of a game. Usually it's just, I guess it's probably just a matter of optimization from the developers, and I think it's getting easier and easier to be sloppy at coding and making graphics.
However, you know, speaking of frame drops and all that stuff, you know, we were just asking what's a game that just came out that's pretty graphically intensive, but I was thinking, remember... How we were trying to fix in Glassbreaker whenever enemies spawned, there was a frame drop?
Yeah.
And that was due to the engine.
Yeah.
So
we fixed that.
Even in a game like this though, that is not necessarily graphically demanding, if the engine is not optimized, that could still cause a problem. So
The name of the company you were asking me in a previous episode, it's Double Helix is the dev.
Oh,
of this
Double
game.
Helix.
Yeah. So
okay. Did they make something else?
I would have felt really bad if they had provided us with a review copy, but...
They got our money instead.
Yeah.
Well, they're not my money.
They got my money for the PS4, but yeah.
It was on sale for dirt cheap a while ago, wasn't it? On PC?
Yeah.
Like $2? $4? $5? I think it was $4.
Yeah.
Oh, well. That's not very...
It's worth the price of entry. It's only 15 is the retail, so...
Yeah, even that's pretty cheap.
Yeah. For a game like this, you can get a lot of replay value out of it.
So it's cool that the Switch is launching with a Zelda title. And from what I've heard, and read, and watched, and seen, it is the new standard for Zelda games, and possibly all games.
Wow.
It's pretty lofty. It's a pretty lofty thing. Pretty lofty claim, you might say. However, there is a hilarious story which I did not know about until today. And it's that...
It's going to be old news now, but...
It is going to be old news now. If you've been paying attention to the Switch internet culture...
I haven't at all, really. I've seen some videos, like the trailers and stuff. That's about it.
Well, this is a more more real-life thing. Less about the video games themselves. How this happens is... When they print the cartridges... By the way, Switch games are cartridges now, just like the 3DS, right?
Yeah.
And they're much smaller than a disc. A disc is big. You can't swallow a disc, but... They're worried about people, maybe babies or small toddlers and infants, accidentally swallowing Switch cartridges because they're so small. So what they did is they put a bitter agent. They sprayed these carts with a bittering agent. Now, I can't verify this. However, I have seen from multiple sources on the internet, they say the cartridges taste terrible. And that's intentional, apparently. Because Nintendo doesn't want anybody to accidentally eat these cartridges.
They find out that they taste terrible. I like to see the grown adults putting these carts in their mouth
to
test it out.
But that's the great part. If Nintendo says, hey, we're bittering up these cartridges so that nobody will taste them.
Yeah, they're going to fucking taste them.
Everybody's going to taste them, exactly.
Yeah, and they're going to do it on stream.
Exactly.
Everyone's, yeah, of course.
And
of
that's
course.
What happened. So that's interesting. I had no
idea.
I didn't
even know about that. It's funny.
I would believe it if it was true, but also if it was false, I would... Well, I guess I believe that too, but... I kind of want it to be true. It's kind of funny. And the controllers themselves. The one person that I was watching on Twitch play The Legend of Zelda had some gripes about the controllers, just saying that they're very small. I mean, everybody said that so far. Everybody said that they're small. And that got me thinking back to the GameCube era. The GameCube controller itself, fantastic. Maybe
pretty
one
awesome, yeah.
Maybe the best controller I've ever played with. Maybe. Extremely ergonomic. You know, with the handles, the grips, and the analog L and R buttons. Extremely ergonomic. But the D-pad on that thing, holy crap.
A little small.
Do you remember the game pad? The D-pad on the GameCube? It was...
I played a lot of Capcom vs. SNK2 with the controller. And that's what you used. Was that
you have to
D-pad?
Use the D-pad?
Well, you don't have to,
well,
but...
Well, it's much better,
too. You can't play a fighting game like that. A 2D fighting game with an analog stick unless there's something wrong with your head.
And, you know, I used to play Resident Evil for the GameCube. And, you know, that works fine with the analog stick. But sometimes you want precision... Sometimes you want precision. You always want precision. But if you want to use the D-pad, here's a fun fact. The D-pad on the GameCube, I can't verify this, I don't have the evidence, but I have a very strong feeling that it's the exact same D-pad that was used in the Game Boy Advance.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the exact same one. I think, like, they had this plastic mold for a D-pad.
And
they
just
like,
made too many of them. And they were like, we gotta put these, yeah. We gotta find some use for these pieces of plastic. These D-pads aren't going to be useful in any other application except for this. We got to design the game controller around it.
Yep, that's
and
what
they did.
Somehow
they still made the best controller.
They did.
Except for the D-pad.
Except for the D-pad.
If it had the D-pad of the Xbox One, that would probably be ideal. It's nice and clicky.
Yeah.
I like the D-pad on the Xbox One.
And you know, even the Game Boy Advance SP, that would have been a cool D-pad. Because even though that's tiny, it still clicks. And it feels
good.
Yeah,
that's a good one, too. That's a small one.
Yeah.
It's also smaller, and that would have been okay, I think, on the GameCube controller.
But no, it's the one on the GameCube is just way too small, but super comfortable.
We were talking about doing a long-form or an analysis about the history of controllers. That wouldn't be as much of an analysis, except more of just a history lesson, I guess.
It'd be informative. But, you know, that's how this channel started, with informative videos. You know,
it started with us playing
Mario
Hearthstone
RPG?
Arenas.
Oh yeah, yeah.
And Super Mario RPG had an RPG and an LP we never finished.
But you know, I was thinking about that earlier today, actually, Joe. We started this channel just like you said, doing some games and just I put up this informative video on cheat codes, and then before I knew it, a couple months later, I guess, we were somehow known for game design.
Yeah.
How did that happen? We were doing informative videos, informational videos.
Yeah.
We were... Is this revealing too much?
No, it's fine.
I don't know what happened, but all of a sudden we were doing game design talk.
Yeah.
From where?
We're not even...
From our
game
butts.
Designers, especially then we weren't.
No.
We weren't game designers, now we're like amateur game designers.
And yeah, we know a lot more now than we used to, but... Huh. It was a very weird time. That I didn't realize until looking back on it, you know?
This is really fun. You can cancel out of your charge attack into a dash, which hopefully I succeed at here. There we go. Pretty sweet.
So the Switch controllers. People say they're small. I don't know about that, but I have seen have you seen the plus and minus buttons on those things?
No.
They look like they're a millimeter wide. They look so small that they're impossible to hit.
Wow.
I wish I could show you a picture. But I don't want to because I have to pull it up and
yeah,
I'm not going to do it.
You've seen them before.
Yeah. So if you've seen them, if you're watching this and you've seen them and they're actually not that small and you've seen them in real life, I don't know.
And what's your favorite controller?
Leave it in the comments. Leave it in the comments. Ghoul School.
Would you say yours is the GameCube controller, Ed?
Me? Well, okay. Let's go through it methodically. We have the PlayStation 1 controller. No, I'm just kidding. We had the N64 controller.
No. Dreamcast? Nope.
No. That's still, I mean, it's fine, but it's not very comfortable.
D-pad's not too nice on the Dreamcast controller either.
And the hand grips don't feel great either.
No.
So, what do we have? PlayStation 2? It's fine. It's a refinement of the PlayStation 1 controller, which yeah. You'd say the same about the PS3 and the PS4.
PlayStation 3 got smaller. Yeah, I mean, out of all the PlayStation controllers, I would say the PS4 one is the best one. It's just more and more refined, but they're all very similar.
Yeah.
Especially to a layman, like, if you're not playing a lot of video games and you held them back to back, like somebody who doesn't play video games wouldn't even be able to tell you the difference between the PS2, 3, and 4 controllers.
I got it. The best controller ever made was the original Xbox controller, not the S.
Oh yeah,
the original.
Yep.
And I actually read this today. A fun fact was that controller was molded for the hands of Andre the Giant.
Yeah. Yeah, I like bigger controllers. Like I just started using skins on my controllers because I have bigger hands and. I started using skins, and it's more comfortable. It's partly because you don't slip on the controllers as much because it's that slick plastic. But
Brainwalker.
It makes it a little bit bigger. Oh yeah, this is like another introduction of a normal enemy, but as a mini boss.
Cool.
They're very easy, especially after you've killed as many of them as I have.
And fun fact, so I need to finish this. Not only was the Xbox controller molded after Andre the Giant's hands, but when they were testing that controller, Andre the Giant was there, and they let him test it. And when he picked up the controller, he said,
"It's too big.
What the hell is this?"
And that's when they knew that they had to mold millions of these controllers to be distributed with the Xbox. The original Xbox,
right.
Which is not the Xbox One. Xbox One is the newest one, which we call a bone now.
The bone, because that's the only way we know how to differentiate things, is to call them bones or not bones. Sonic the Hedgehog? Sonic the Hedgehog Bones.
Yeah.
That's two.
Sonic I never 2. Owned an Xbox. I never owned the original Xbox.
I have one right down there.
No, you don't.
On the bookshelf, on the bottom shelf.
Oh, yeah, that is an Xbox.
I bought it at a yard sale for $4.
Huh.
I didn't know what to do with it, though. I wanted to... Like, if I had all the time in the world, I would have done one of those emulation stations. The original Xbox is good for emulation, turns out.
Hmm.
For, like SNES emulation and... Old school console emulation.
That's like something another thing I probably would never do, make a MAME cabinet.
Yeah.
That would be awesome.
Yeah.
Like I would love to have that, but I don't want to take the time and learn how to do it.
Yeah, it's
a lot. You could probably pay somebody to do it for you, but
sure.
There I don't have the money, so it's probably not going to happen.
Yeah, it's not worth the time investment now though.
But I love arcade games.
How do you get through? Oh, you got a dash. You got a dash.
Probably the most of anyone on this channel, between the two of us.
The most anyone.
I'm probably the bigger arcade game fan.
The recycling center, huh? Is that where we go to tell all of our jokes? Because we recycle them?
Here we go. I'm going back because I looked at the map and I realized I missed a power-up.
So. Oh, no. Okay.
The camera, unfortunately, is situated for only going right.
Huh.
So you're trying to go... Trying to go back through this layout here.
Is there another way to go back? Like you can go up and around or something?
Yeah, you wind up back here in a different way.
But
I think
still.
Later in the game, and you go from the left again. But yeah, you would think that they would make the camera shift to the left when you're going backwards through there, because some people are going to be going backwards through there, like I just did.
And the camera's not even angled here; it was only angled when you were on that conveyor.
Sorry, there was a cut there.
Oh yeah, I did see that.
One of my 15-minute cuts. Oh, I don't even know what power up was there. Sorry about that. There was a power up there, an important one.
Let's just say it was a health pickup or something.
Yeah, it was one of those type of power ups.
So if you're using this video as a guide, it'll be a surprise. Surprise.
Leave your favorite controller in the comments.
Oh yeah, we were still talking about that.
Yeah, we were talking about what's our favorite controllers. I have a hard time deciding.
Methodically. Let's continue. Wii? Not very comfortable. Remotes?
No, the Wii remotes,
not very
no.
comfortable. Especially when you're holding it sideways so you could play a game like Mario.
No.
The
not
worst.
Comfortable.
The worst. Not the worst, but pretty bad.
I was saying the Xbox controller. I think that's where we were, the original Xbox controller. I like big controllers, but that was anti-ergonomic. Like,
right.
I would rather hold an NES, a little cramped up box, than the original Xbox controller.
Yeah, the NES, the original NES controller, not super comfortable, but miles ahead of the original Xbox controller.
Yeah.
Still. And also, black and white buttons, remember those?
Yeah.
That was real easy.
Not too good.
No, it was really...
Oh, we were talking about this in an IM when we were talking about potentially doing a history of controllers video.
Right.
We were talking about the one huge disadvantage of the GameCube controller. There's no L1 button.
Yeah!
There's L, R, and Z. Z, which is basically R1.
That was a ridiculous choice.
Yeah, that was a poor design choice. You want to have two shoulder buttons on either side. that frees up a lot of design space and a lot of control space. Because a lot of games at that point, everything was basically being developed for the PS2, for better or worse. Mostly for worse, because it was the weakest of all the consoles. But that had four buttons on the top.
Right.
It had four shoulder buttons. So they would have to figure out another way to do it on the other
consoles.
Yeah, you would lose a button. So they would... That was an awkward time for gaming. Like, as far as design goes, they were still kind of... They had mostly figured out how to do 3D, but there was still a lot of remnants of getting lost in games in a bad way, not in like an open world way, but just in a not knowing where to go, and you'd have to look up where to go a lot of the time. There's still a lot of problems in design, like as far as 3D combat goes and lock on, how all that shit works, and even some camera problems during that era, during the
PS2
GameCube era.
I mean, Mario Sunshine is notorious for its bad camera at times. It's still a fantastic game.
They were still figuring out a lot of stuff, a lot of issues that you don't see so much anymore. I mean, games are better than ever now.
I mean, they continue to be better than ever every year, arguably. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I think they get a little bit better every year. At least for the last few years. But I think there was that awkward growing period that was in the PlayStation N64 days and into the PS2 GameCube days.
And it's only in retrospect that I would realize that I would consider that to be true. Same with cell phones, you know? 5-10 years ago, when I had my Motorola Razr, that wasn't like an awkward time when phones were, they didn't know if they wanted to be tablets, or not tablets, but like touch screens or giant screens or small screens or black and white, you know, like Game Boy style colors. Like, that was sort of in the middle. And I think this was a similar thing. Like, people didn't know what to do, so we just tried everything, including taking out an L1 button.
Yeah, it wasn't a great choice.
Anytime you wanted to port a game from the PlayStation to the GameCube, you would have to rework the controls. I never considered this before. That's kind of crazy.
Yeah. You might, if you're planning on releasing it cross-platform, you're not going to utilize those top four buttons,
right,
possibly, so you're going to be wasting shoulder buttons on the PS2 controller.
You know, they kind of
not using them, I guess.
They kind of justified it, because they didn't call it the R1 button, it was the Z button.
Yeah.
So, it's not an R1 button, but it's this extra button that we have to do something else with.
In terms of comfortability, I guess. Comfortability is the word?
Comfort.
In terms of comfort, probably the GameCube is up there.
It's up there
on the list, and also, yeah, I think just overall, it's up there.
Yeah, I mean, the N64 was not super comfortable.
No, it was all right.
Although I will say
that was the first controller, the first major controller, I guess, that really attempted to be ergonomic, though.
Yeah,
and I think they did a decent job with it.
The left hand, the touching the analog stick and also resting your finger on the Z button, that's comfortable. The left hand on the N64 controller?
Pretty good,
pretty good. The right hand, it's okay. It's fine. There's a lot of buttons to hit. And you failed. Uh-oh.
Yeah, we had a death there.
Okay. So, yeah, GameCube, good. Wii, I can't say anything about the Wii U. I mean, that's all, like, the major controllers. I guess the 360, of course, was renowned for being pretty comfortable and a pretty good controller overall. Except for the D-pad. There's always something. There's always something with controllers, you know?
Which one did you just say?
The 360.
Oh, 360. Yeah, the D-pad on that was
was
garbage.
And is, yeah. Even now.
Like, if you're playing a game that the D-pad is important, if you're playing like Spelunky or a platformer game and you prefer to use the D-pad like I do, it wasn't the best.
If you want proof of this, go back and watch our old videos. Because we started this channel with an Xbox 360 controller.
Yeah, with a busted D-pad. It didn't go left very well.
No.
And you can hear us complain about that on a lot of old episodes.
And that wasn't something that broke. It started like that. That controller was always like that.
And then I bought us some Xbox One controllers to upgrade.
And then
both of them, the R bumper broke.
And both of my bumpers are broken now.
Oh, really?
Pretty sweet. You have to push really hard at a certain angle.
Yeah, they're so expensive.
They're
too
expensive.
Controllers are really expensive now.
And controllers have been expensive for a couple generations. I remember trying to buy.
They get more and more complex.
I think
they probably cost more and more to make. Like with the PS4, you've got the touchpad on them.
Yeah. That's
crazy. There's a reason that they cost more.
They're more technologically advanced, so they're going to cost a little bit more too.
I forget if I failed. I think I failed here, actually. I think I get killed here.
Like, I remember going to the store, going to GameStop, and buying extra GameCube controllers. And I think the cheapest I ever saw them were like $25 or $30, you know? But now, You want to buy an Xbox controller or a PS4 controller?
Yeah, they're like $50.
Or God forbid, if you wanted to buy a Pro controller for the Switch, guess how much, Joe? Guess how much?
I don't even know. $100. I mean,
you've seen the Pro controller, right?
Yeah.
It's just a regular controller. $70.
Oh, that's a lot.
That's like Apple level of
I didn't know how
price
much
gouging. It's not price gouging, but it's an Apple level of up. What do you call it? Price upping.
Yeah.
Upselling.
So I died there because I got there with less health.
That's okay.
And I was not, I don't think I was trying my best here. But here you want to push this phase because, to be honest, I don't know what to do there. So I just hit her with two birds, and that always gets her.
Two birds and one stone.
And you'll notice that they reused some of the animations from those previous, the Tompu type of bosses.
Oh, right.
So they really reused that a lot. So a lot of the bosses are pretty similar. But this boss is different enough, I think.
Oh yeah, this is a move we've seen.
There's other stuff. Yeah, this move. But yeah, they didn't have like this move that I am gonna skip here. We are gonna push through this.
Huh. Can you not dodge that?
Those red things, well, it's pushing you outward constantly.
Oh.
It keep those that purple stuff pushes you outward, so it's awkward to control, and those red bullets do a ton of damage.
Huh.
So I got killed there. I got killed on this boss a few times, and I learned to just push that face without. Oh, this is bad, though, because I don't have enough mana. I wonder what I did here. Oh, you just waited till we got the mana. Okay.
Nice.
But you get a really cool ability here. You get your last of your three L1 plus a button abilities here. So we have our bird, which we got first, and then we have our dipodal saucer.
Mm-hmm.
We get that second, and here we're going to get our panther. Our robot panther.
Of course.
Our ghost robot panther.
I like how you qualified it
multiple
twice.
Times, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we got to fill an hour here, so.
We do. Oh, tetrapodal. Tetrapodal.
Oh, I didn't even know he was called a tetrapodal robo panther. Okay, so he's not ghostly. He's a tetrapodal.
Well, no, he is a ghost. You're
but
right.
There he goes. He's so the way that this guy works is the more enemies that he hits, the more his damage up. His damage goes up. For each enemy that he hits. So he's good for a line of enemies. You'll notice where I use him, though. Basically everywhere. I just throw him out.
Okay.
And he can also be used at points on the map where there's a panther symbol to warp between two panther symbols. The problem with these panther symbols is you don't know where they're going to warp. Sometimes they warp to a different map in the game. It's never clear. You can't choose which panther spot you want to warp to. They always warp to one other one, and they're not indicated on the map which one warps where. They're not numbered or colored or anything.
We talked about this.
We did talk about this on another episode, but I just wanted to reiterate, since we now have the panther, that I don't like the way that the warps were designed in this game. When you get to the end of the game, it backtracking and figuring out where to go does become overly difficult.
But what about the arrow? The arrow always tells you where to go.
The arrow always tells you where to go to advance the story, but if you're trying to backtrack and find your missing power-ups, you can see, this is awesome game design, because they give you a line of enemies, and the panther will go down and then kill the next line of enemies. They really give you one of the most powerful points in the game to use that panther to really show you
pretty cool
how effective it can be in certain situations. So generally, the bird is going to be better against single target or flying enemies, but the panther, here's another example of where you can use it. I'm not sure if I did it here, but no, I probably just cheesed it. No, I did. I went up and threw a panther at them too. Okay, cool. But there are some parts in the game that are kind of cheesy, like you can just hang out under there, and you notice how I could just swing at them with my charge attack. And there's a lot of parts of the game. They can't hit you from there because their bullets disappear when they hit the ground instead of hitting you. So nice. They'll try and shoot you, and they can't hit you. So you can just spend as much time under there just hitting them with charge shots till they're dead. So
pretty cheesy.
Yeah, it's pretty cheesy, and I do use it in the last level to give myself an advantage.
Well, you're a cheeser, good sir.
Yes. Best controller.
How are we still talking about this? I feel like we've exhausted all the popular options. I mean,
yeah,
if you want to go really weird, we can say, like, Atari Lynx, Jaguar. Which one of those was the thing? Weren't they both a thing?
I feel like I'm going to get attacked in the comments, and I am worried about getting attacked in the comments by saying my favorite controller, but okay, I'm going to do it. No, I'm just kidding. I'm actually not worried about that. Go ahead and tell me why I'm wrong, or... Well, no, you can't really tell me why I'm wrong about what my favorite controller is. It's just an opinion.
Yeah, but if you disagree, tell us why.
I would say that it's pretty close between the Xbox One and the... Nintendo GameCube. Yeah, those two.
Yeah.
I would say it's between those two.
I like GameCube more, but it has been several years since I've held one, so I haven't done a direct comparison.
The thing I don't like about the Xbox One is the freaking triggers break.
Yeah. Yeah, what's up with that? Microsoft. Oh my god. Two brand new controllers. Both broke within, what, like 6 months?
Yeah, out of the current gen controllers, I would say, yeah, the Xbox One for sure.
Yeah.
The PS4 controller's alright, though, but one thing that I don't like about it is the sticks, the twin sticks, are not as good for twin stick shooters.
Hmm.
They're not as easy to aim for some reason. It's not built as well for that. Maybe for like first person shooters, it doesn't make as much difference. I don't know. I haven't played as many of those in the current gen. But the Xbox 360 controller and the Xbox One controller are pretty good for twin stick shooters.
I have a question for you. How about that touchpad in the center of the PS4? How do you feel about that thing?
It's not really utilized that much as far as gameplay goes. You can use it, like, to enter your name or enter a code or something. Like, if you're entering a discount code or a coupon code into
You can?
Oh, do you when like... When you're buying something on the PlayStation Store, I guess I've used it a few times there. It's maybe a little more efficient than using the D-pad. I guess you can use it to type to people. I've done that a couple of times, but... I don't talk to people too much on the PS4. I mostly play by myself. It's
underdeveloped or underutilized or both.
You just press it. It's mostly just used as another button.
Is it? It's two separate buttons, right? Is it?
Yeah, it has a left side and a right side.
Right.
Some games only just use it as one big button, but if they want to, you can press on the left or the right. The developers have the option that you can just press left or right.
That was always a strange, because there's no start button on that controller.
In this game, in Strider, for instance, it activates the map.
Either side?
Yeah, you just slam that button and you get a map.
Just slam it.
So, I mean, it feels pretty good because it's big. If you just want to pause the game, and you don't ever hit it by mistake unless you're like a complete... And you have very little control over your thumbs. you'd have to be really some kind of a monster to be pressing it by mistake while you're playing a game. Never mind.
Well, I have something related to that about the PS4 controller, and I can't vouch for this personally because I've never played the... Well, I have played the game for about 10 minutes once. Bloodborne.
I might be able to answer your question then.
So PS4, and Bloodborne in particular, this is a software developer choice, not a hardware choice. The developers from Software have made it so that the PS4 controller will do gestures in response to your motion controls on the controller.
Mm-hmm.
So if you do a certain gesture, like you turn to the left or you turn to the right in a certain way, it'll do a gesture in-game, which previously was only accessible through the back button or the select button on your controller. But now it's motion controls, and you cannot disable it. So if you're one of those people who...
Wait, was this like an update?
No, this is a thing on Bloodborne that I think is always there.
It's always been there?
To my belief.
Huh, I don't think I've ever activated that on purpose or by mistake, because I didn't even know about it. And I played Bloodborne for a really long time, and I got embarrassingly not very far.
That's how they all go. But, I mean, I've seen streamers, like I said, I haven't ever done it myself, but I've seen streamers who have this problem and, like, struggle with it sometimes, because they're kind of animated, you know?
Especially, if you're streaming, you're probably going to exaggerate your expressions and your movements a little bit, and maybe you'll raise your hands about something and you'll do something by mistake. I'm sure that's...
Yeah, and you cannot disable it.
That's weird.
There is no option to disable it.
I didn't know about that.
So, what's the deal, you know? What's the deal? It's just kind of a weird design. Like, the whole pad, that... What do you even call that thing? A touchpad?
Yeah.
That whole thing was weird to me. So, rip the start and select buttons. Rip. Forever. You know?
It has those, though. They're called the share... Well, the share button is different. So I guess, you just have what's called the options button. It's basically the start button, though.
Yeah, and the Xbox replaced select with back.
You see that panther?
Oh, yeah?
That is one good panther right there.
That's one good panther.
That's a good use of the panther. So they give you a lot of situations where the panther is useful in this game. Feels good.
Is this a big map? This is one part of the map, right? If you zoom out, is it gigantic?
What you do is you press the triangle button and it zooms out to the overall map, and there's like 8 to 10 areas, I think, in the whole game, and you pick the areas. It can be a little bit difficult to tell which area leads into the other areas. Sometimes it's a little bit difficult to tell which it's going to lead to, but once you've played for a little bit, you'll figure it out. It's not too bad. Here I think we're going to be doing a lot of backtracking, though, because you see there's a bunch of doors down there that I haven't accessed now that we have the orange, and I didn't skip any of this stuff. I was fairly thorough going through this game, especially because it's on hard mode.
Do we want to speed through this in post?
Nah. No? I sped through the stuff that I think was necessary to speed through.
Okay.
I think we'll just show this. But, yeah, so game controllers, man. Just kidding.
So, yeah, I guess the bottom line is that there hasn't been a perfect controller yet, but the GameCube, in my opinion, it's up there. It's pretty good.
Yeah, we're pretty close to perfect controllers.
But even then, the buttons, we still don't agree on all the buttons. You know, PlayStation used to have a start and select. The N64 only had a start button. The GameCube only had a start button.
Right.
And now we have a back button, like on the Xbox One controller. There's a back button. And a menu button.
PS4 has the big.
Yeah, the slam pad.
The slam pad. Yeah, but let's call it the slam pad.
There is no start button on these controllers anymore. Even the Wii. The Wii had a plus and a minus instead of a start and select. So what are we doing? I thought we had this sorted out, but apparently we're still exploring new ways, which is a great thing. You know, I'm all for that. But what I thought was standardized turns out not to be such. And I wonder what'll happen in the future. Because what's the Wii? The Switch. I don't know what the Switch controller's like. I think it has the SNES button setup. So it's got like A, B, X, or B, A. What is it? B, A?
B, A, Y, X? Yeah.
God, why did they do that?
I don't know. But that has set the standard.
It has set the standard, which Xbox has defied. Don't they have those backwards where it's ABXY instead of BAYX? I'm pretty sure that's the case. Look at an Xbox controller versus an SNES controller. The buttons are reversed.
Yeah, they are. They are.
Right. So, yeah, that, I don't know. I don't know, man. What other controllers have there even been? What other consoles have come out? Like the Steam controller, for example.
I haven't tried a Steam controller. So maybe that's the best controller.
Oh, you know what is the best controller? Ooyah.
What the fuck is that?
I don't know. No, I do know what it is. It was that Kickstarter console that ran on Android. Remember that thing? It was a big deal until it came out.
I vaguely remember a weird console that was Kickstarted. I don't know if it was... I guess it was that one.
It had about...
It was probably that one. As
much of a fanfare as the Nokia N-Gage, only it was Kickstarted.
Yeah.
You bought one, didn't you? You bought an N-Gage, didn't you?
That was a meme on the internet. I know what you're going with.
Internet meme, or was that a
That was an internet meme, yeah.
Meme.
I think that was an internet meme. I don't know. Post it in the comments. What do we want to talk about? Lou Links now?
I don't know. Can we?
Yeah, I guess. Anybody out there a member of Lou, Life, the Universe, and Everything from...
Lou Links.
Yeah, Lou Links.
Do you remember Lou Links, best site... Okay, I'm going to say this. Lou Links was the best site I have ever seen on the internet, period.
I'm going to say it was the best site of its time. I don't know. But
I still hold it in the highest regard, Lou Links.
Anybody out there that was a member of Lou Links? Because Ed and I were both had Lou Links accounts. It was a closed forum and link sharing site.
Yeah, back when Mega Upload was the thing?
Yeah, it was... I mean, it was before Mega Upload. Kind of Mega Upload Links took it over for a while, but
yeah, it used to be like it started out as cool links to cool websites.
And
oh crap,
fuck. We'll talk about it in the next one.